Hello, everyone. We're going to give people a little more time to join in on the call before we get started.
Have you any other people signed up in the last 10 minutes? Just checking.
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
I can try to figure that out.
Do they automatically get an invitation if they sign up? Is that how that works?
They should, yeah. There shouldn't be any.
Okay, there's no user. You don't need to do anything.
No, as long as you click the registration link and put in your information, you should get the link, yeah.
That's what I did, and it worked perfectly.
Okay. I'll give it just another minute here before we get started, but thanks everyone for coming out for our relocation information meeting. All right, I think we might as well get started. If anybody comes in at this point, we can still let them in and we'll get going with the preliminaries. So like I said, thanks everyone for coming to this Zoom meeting where we're going to talk about the proposal to relocate Woodstock Library to 10 Dixon Avenue, just outside the hamlet of Woodstock. I'm Ivy Gawker, I'm the library director, and I'm joined tonight by Jeff Collins, our board president. So without further ado, we'll get going on our little presentation for you. And of course, we'll have time for question and answers after we speak tonight. So this we start out with this little preliminary video just to give everybody kind of a sense of what it is we're talking about here. So this will show you some views of our current library building. And I wanna make special note, take a look at the roof of this building. It has, I think, maybe 38 different surfaces is what somebody counted out once. So it's a bit of a complicated building. But this video will start out with some views of the current library and then go to the new building so that you get a bit of a sense of the context of what we're talking about here tonight. And I know in the past, the audio on this video hasn't come through very well. So I'm gonna see if I can play it without sound just to make it easier on everyone's ears. But so this is obviously our current Woodstock Library building. We made this video right around the holidays, so the building's still decorated. That's me coming out. If I haven't met you yet, that's what I look like. You'll see me around town. And then this is the short drive to the new building at 10 Dixon Avenue, the potential new building, I should say. And these are some exterior images to give you a sense of the shape of the building, its layout on the lot, the entrances, that sort of thing. You'll see solar panels over here. We'll talk about those a little bit later. Okay, so that's 10 Dixon. And now, Jeff, I'll hand it over to you.
Okay, so one of the questions obviously people have is why move? Basically, we feel it's important to move because of the conditions of the existing library building. First, it's not ADA compliant. That's something that we really can't fix because there's no way for people to get to the upstairs in the building, the current building. Next, it's poorly insulated. We actually did a pressure test to kind of find out where there were gaps in the insulation, and we couldn't even do it because there were so many gaps in the insulation that we couldn't get the building up to pressure to do the pressure test. The HVAC is inefficient, it's old, it's room air conditioners where there's air conditioners. There's no airflow through the building. And as people who have been in the building can testify, there are mold issues within the building. Those mold issues are not just affecting human beings, but they could also affect the books. So there's some concern about the collection in the library, given that they have, that there's mold issues there. We did a structural survey of the building last year to kind of get the sense of what it does support and how the structure works and how the structure is holding up the building. And the results of that showed that there's not a single place in the current building that meets New York State code of 150 pounds per square foot for a library. There are areas of the building that have as little as 16 square foot of structural supports. It's not gonna fall in, but it does not meet code for a library. The roof is badly designed, as Ivy kind of said, as she showed the aerial view of the library. The roof lines are inconsistent. Sometimes they create valleys, sometimes they create little ponds. Ponds and roofs and valleys and roofs are not usually a good idea. And lastly, the parking is very limited. The parking is just off the street parking. To get to the parking, you either have to pull in from a busy road and then back out onto that road, or back in from a busy road and then pull out to that road. And then the turn for me onto 212, if you're turning left, is almost a blind turn. I've had a couple times where it's been pretty dangerous. Someone hasn't seen me when I pull out. So it's not a great parking area. Contrary to that, the building at 10 Dixon Ave has 44 parking spaces. All of them are off the street. As you saw in the video, you pull off the street, you pull into the parking lot, you park and you walk into the back of the building, which is really going to be positioned as the front entrance to our library, assuming that we get the bond passed. It has modern, efficient HVAC systems. They're really, really incredibly good systems. This will allow us to move air through the building. I think we'll be able to do 10 air changes per hour, I think is the code, and I think we can accomplish that with these systems. As Ivy pointed out in the video, there are pre-existing solar panels, so it's already more energy efficient than the other building would ever be. It's also got much better insulation than the current building has, and we expect it to be significantly more energy efficient than the current building. It does have an odd on-site generator, so it could be used as a warming station if need arises. I know that we're using the community center for that, but if we need more than the community center can provide, the building could be an on-site, or could be a warming center. Some people ended up using warming centers in Woodstock this last winter, as we all know. There's fiber optic internet connection to the building existing. I think it's the only building in town that has fiber optic internet. That is phenomenal for people who want to do business or want to do work at the library or just want to fast, decent connection. As you can see on the outside, there's a nice covered sitting area. I think there's a barbecue there. I don't think that's going to stay, but there is one there now. And it's a nice place to hang out and on good weather. Lastly, the interior is almost 12,000 square feet. That is roughly the size of what our plan of service needs. And we will get into the actual layout of the interior later. I will take you through that and show you how it supports the plan of service.
Yeah, so as Jeff said, aside from looking at, the physical structure of the building and whether it's adequate, we also need to look at the services the library is providing and how whatever facility we're in is making those services happen. So as some of you may have been involved with in the last year, the library put together its new plan of service, and a big part of that was getting community feedback, so that we were asking Woodstockers, what do you want your library to do for you? And then we turn that into a roadmap for the things that we want to provide. So some of what we were hearing in these plan of service meetings was that Woodstockers want a community hub. They want, you know, a public space where people can gather. It's very basic, but you'll, you know, when you look around, you realize it's actually in short supply these days. So the library needs to serve as a connecting place for people to come for different reasons, but to interact with each other foremost. They wanted programming for all ages. That's kind of the library's bread and butter. We want to have children's story times. We want to have adult book discussions. We want to have, you know, help for senior citizens who are trying to do their taxes, everything in between. The library is there to be providing all of that. We need a place that will support and celebrate the rich history of Woodstock. We all know Woodstock has an amazing history for being such a small town, and the library actually already has great collections on that, but we have a hard time serving them to the public because our space is so cramped. We don't have the kind of climate control necessary to make sure that those historical and archival collections stay in good shape for the long term. We want excellent patron service, which I think we already provide, but it's worth saying that the staff is very cramped in this building. They're making the best with a small space, but it is sometimes difficult to do all the things we need to do as staff members, because the circulation desk is, you know, where we're also trying to do programming, where we're also trying to do one-on-one computer help. So we have a lot of different activities happening in one small space, and it's hard to do that smoothly without having all of these activities interfere with each other and get in each other's way. A very important pillar of the plan of service is, of course, that any new facilities that the library is planning need to be designed with these specifications in mind. So we aren't going to move into a new building if it doesn't kind of hit these bullet points of the plan of service. And then finally, we learned that people want the library to be helping support business and entrepreneurship in the community. And a lot of that comes back to what Jeff was saying with fiber optic internet, being a space where you have a good, reliable, fast internet connection. But there's also things the library can be doing in terms of providing like kinds of co-work spaces where maybe you have a room all to yourself for an hour where you can do whatever you need to do. So these are the things we were hearing from the community that you want. And of course we want to provide them for you. So now I'll talk a little bit about the ways we see 10 Dixon supporting the needs that were addressed in the plan of service. So as I alluded to just now, the new building will allow us to have sort of breakaway meeting rooms that are removed from all the other activity of the library. This is a quiet room with a table and some chairs and a door that you can close, so that if you need to have a meeting with somebody privately, you can do that. That'll be space that's bookable by the public. We also need, or this building, sorry, would also provide us with a large multi-purpose program room. Right now at the library, we have a small upstairs room that's mostly used for children's programming, but in a pinch, we have other kinds of meetings that happen up there as well. And as Jeff mentioned, it's up a staircase and it's difficult for some people to access. But in this space, we'll have that multi-purpose room, and we will be putting in an elevator so that everybody can get to the floor where that room is. And it'll be flexible so we can have different kinds of programming happening there on different days. This building will have dedicated children and teen spaces, which our current building has, you know, you could call them spaces, but they're really more like little pockets. They're very small, cramped. And like I said, they're contiguous with the rest of the building. So if you have a children's story hour, you're not going to be able to quietly read a book elsewhere in the building, in the current layout. This new building will have a dedicated space for archives and historical collections. It will have a secured entry, and it will also be climate controlled so that we can make sure our sort of rare, fragile materials are being kept in the safest way possible, and that they're secured from damage or from being, you know, taken out of the library without permission. This building will maintain our current service points. And by that, I mean, we have the circulation desk now, and we also have the walk-up window, and we'll have that here as well. You'll still have both of those options. And then because it's a larger facility, we'll have a dedicated desk upstairs as well, where you can speak to a staff member and get help with anything you're going to need. So there'll be more points at which you can interact with our staff in this building. It'll have better facilities for all of the various back of house activities the staff is doing. So we'll have more space to process books. We'll be able to design that workflow better because we're sort of working with a blank palette here. So, you know, the books come in, we process the holds, we put them on the shelf. Right now that's all happening in a 10 foot square space, but in this new building, we'll be able to design it to flow much more smoothly for our staff. And like I said, here you'll have individual study desks where you can work privately. And we'll also have just nice quiet places to read a book. We have, as you can see in this building, there's lots of windows, some of them with mountain views, and we have plans to put a comfortable chair next to that window so you can just sit and have some quiet time, kind of like a classic library reading experience. I'll just say that the sort of overall goal here is that the library can be serving all of these different functions at once, and they can all coexist without interfering with one another, so that you can have a loud children's program happening on the first floor while someone is completely engrossed in a novel on the second floor or an art book. It's going to allow much more of a richness of activity coexisting without interfering with each other. And this one's you, Jeff.
Oh, sorry. okay, so I want to talk about the exterior and how we're going to repurpose the exterior. So the first change to, actually the only change to the exterior in the back, which will be the entrance, is the ADA compatible elevator. And do you mind just highlighting where that is, Ivy, where that's going to be? It's going to be in that area. That little lump there is going to be expanded just a little bit more to fit the elevator into it. The front porch, which is currently not enclosed, will be enclosed. That will give us a little bit more space. And we'll add an upstairs section to that, which gives us another egress that's important for the top floor. On the north wing is the rectangular part that's more in the sun, as you see it. We'll be removing interior offices from both the downstairs and the upstairs. And depending what we find structurally, we'll have to increase the structural load support for the upstairs. We expect to find that the upstairs has a typical office structural load of around 60 pounds per square foot. We'll need to increase it to 150 pounds per square foot to support the stacks that will go on the second floor. The first floor of the entire building is on a slab, so there's no issues with the structural load in the first floor. There's also no issues of water in the basement in this new building. The entrance that you see here will be, once you enter the door through the door there. Once you enter the door, we'll change the interior so that you walk into a welcoming front desk, and the staircase that is currently there when you walk in the front door will be moved to further north. I think it's a better setup and more welcoming entrance than what the building has now. The south wing, which is the square part, we'll also remove some interior offices on the first floor to open it up for more book stacks. And on the second floor, we'll make some minimal changes to the walls. It's going to continue to be an office building. It'll be where meeting rooms are, where the staff rooms are, where the staff, or where the director is. And that means we do not need to change the structural support in the south wing because there won't be any stacks in the second level.
Okay, so now I'll walk through some actual floor plans that we have in place so you can get a more concrete idea of what Jeff and I have been talking about here. But This is an overview plan of the first floor. So just to give you some orientation, this is the door you would be coming into to use the library. This is the parking lot up here. And so this is what we call the north wing over here, the sort of long rectangular one. And then this is the south wing down here. But I'm going to walk through closer views of each of these areas so that you can see in a bit more detail. So starting with the south wing, you come in through the main entrance and here's your lobby and your circulation desk. And as Jeff alluded, right now, the staircase here and this desk are sort of swapped. And so this is one of the things that will be changed in the repurposing process. But in this area, you have a dedicated children's space. And so this room is a children's program room, but it can also be flexible. So we know we have some groups that use the library for meetings after hours, and we're thinking this place can serve that as well. So you won't have collections in this room, but you do have like a sink, you have desk space. You know, this can be opened up when you want to have a story hour, or if there's a craft happening, you have the work tables for that. So this is sort of a flexible children's programming room. And then you continue through into the actual book collections. And this is kind of a flowing down this corridor from the youngest readers, then down to older readers here in the teen room. I'll also point out you have the desk for the children's program assistant here to be helping any children who come in and to be that friendly face they see when they first come into the children's area. In this wing, you also have our fiction library, along with some of those, you know, nice, cozy reading areas I was talking about down here, right adjacent to the windows. You also have a bank of computers, because that is something our patrons use quite a bit, is the computers that we provide with printer. And the nice thing about this is that it's still very accessible to the circulation desk, because we do find that, you know, if people are coming in to use our computers, it's not always intuitive how to get onto the internet, how to print out to the printer. So we want to have staff nearby to help people navigate all of that. So this will still be readily accessible to staff. And we are, you know, sort of maximizing any wall space to hold as many collections as we can. So all of these sort of rectangular shapes you see are indicating where there's going to be bookshelves. And if you can see to this level of detail, some of them have, they all have numbers on the top. These ones have sevens on the top. These ones have fours. And that's an indication of how tall the shelves will be. So shelves that are seven high are kind of going to be like just over your head, where you're maybe reaching up to grab a book. But as much as possible, we're trying to space things out so that we can have shelves that are about four high, which is something, you know, that's a level that you'll be able to see over that. And that makes for a much more open feeling space, because we want this, of course, to be a pleasant library to come into. And so we're trying to make as many sort of unbroken vistas as we possibly can to make the space feel nice and open. Behind the circulation desk here, we have a nice big staff workroom, and that's where we'll be doing processing of books, you know, getting the stickers on them so that they can circulate, fixing any books that are damaged, cleaning DVDs that come in. This is just a nice big workspace to support everything that happens at the circulation desk. As Jeff mentioned, right now, this is the area we're calling the front porch. And right now this is opened to the outdoors, but what we will be doing is enclosing it and then making it into the media library. And so that's where you're going to find your DVDs, audiobooks, that sort of thing. And right here is the pickup window, same thing as the walk-up window now. So this will be kind of like quick and easy access just to pick up your holds or just to return a book. And as you can see in the aerials, there's a little like drive through right here. So, you know, conceivably you could drive up into this spot, hop out of your car, run up to this window, return a book, get back in your car and go if you don't have time to make a long visit to the library. This is the north wing of the first floor. And just to orient you, here's that media library I was just talking about. So when we move over here, this is the elevator Jeff mentioned, which will make our whole second floor infinitely more accessible than is the case in our current building. And as you move into this room, this is going to be the nonfiction library. I'll point out here again, you have some bookshelves that are 7 high, some that are 4 high. These small squares are indicating supports that may have to go in to support that second floor load-bearing requirement, because we're going to have, I mean, as you can imagine, stacks of books are much heavier than, you know, office chairs. So if we're going to have collections on the second floor, we have to have extra support on the first floor. So these would be like beams that would be going up to support the second floor. Here you have some of those individual study carrels I mentioned. So this could be a person sitting alone with their laptop getting some work done. This could be a small group meeting or people just reading the newspaper. And then again, we have comfortable seating grouped around the windows so that people can enjoy the view. And then here's an existing staircase that goes to the second floor. But of course, we'll also have this attractive interior staircase for people to use as well. Anything that I missed, Jeff?
Can you point at the elevator?
Elevators are right here. And at these little rooms with things that look like toilets, those are bathrooms, obviously. So you'll see them throughout the building. In our current building, we have one. In this building, it's more like 4 or 5, I think. Okay, and this is moving up to the second floor overview. Again, north and south wings, but I will move into a closer up view of these so you can see what we're talking about. So this is the south wing of the second floor. And as Jeff mentioned, on this floor, we're keeping a lot of the sort of office space structure that the building already has. So over here, you have kind of the administrative wing where you have the director's office, a sort of flexible staff room, the assistant librarian's office, or rather the librarian's office. And then here is that big flexible meeting space I was talking about. So we could have larger children's programs up here. We could have, you know, something like the library forum sort of event could happen up here. It does have a sink as well. So, you know, there's lots of possibility for different sorts of things that could go on in that space. Things that we don't even have in our existing library, you know, kinds of programs that we haven't conceived of because we haven't had a space to support very much. So this room, you know, we would have it open for special events for the most part. Going down this hallway, these are study rooms that can be booked by the public. So if you need to meet with, you know, some people to talk about a new business venture, or maybe you're a student and you have a group project, these are rooms that you would be able to book by the hour to have just a quiet, dedicated space to work together and work on things together. Right now, this is another one of those rooms that's slightly larger to accommodate, you know, a larger group. And then over here, I'll point out you have a staff lounge. So right now, our staff doesn't really have any dedicated space for their breaks, for their lunches. But now they would have a lounge with lockers where they could put all of their belongings. So give them the kind of the break space that they need within the building. What else can I point out here? Up top, we have, this is sort of the foyer, I guess, for the second floor. So we have space along these walls where we could have, you know, local art that we're showing. We want, you know, obviously Woodstock is an arts community. So we want to use wall space in the library to showcase that. This is another one of those nice kind of reading nooks. And then I'll point out, this is the second floor of that enclosed porch. So right now this is an area that's open to the outside, but through the repurposing, we would turn this into another enclosed space, which would allow for gallery space for artwork. Also, more of the art book collection could go here. And I think more importantly, this is allowing for some of that, I'm not sure of the term, but the fire escape egress from the second floor to get people to accessible staircases. So it solves some of the issues we foresee there as well. I'll move over to the north wing of the second floor. And this is going to be our arts Library. So as you know, probably, we have a really wonderful art book collection. And that's, you know, that along with our historical archive collections, there's are things that make our library really special and really unique. So we want to use this new space to showcase that and create a beautiful space to enjoy those collections and learn from those collections. So I'll point out here, you have the stacks for art books, but they're all only 4 high, so that this will really be a nice open room. I believe what this dotted line is showing is where the ceiling could actually be vaulted, so that you have higher ceilings in this space as well. And then in this corner is the history and archives room I was talking about. So this will be a climate controlled space where we'll be able to store our historical collections, everything that's very specific to Woodstock, to Woodstock's writers and painters and sculptors, everything that kind of makes Woodstock special that we have represented in the library would go into this room. And the great thing about it is it has a door that can close. So we don't have to worry about this stuff getting exposed to everything else in the building. We don't have to worry about people walking off with our, you know, precious rare materials. This can finally be a controlled space that assures the sort of long-term accessibility of these materials. And over here, right adjacent to that space, you have another staff service point. So people wouldn't really be able to access this room without having it opened up for them by a staff member who is then here to monitor what they're doing, to answer any questions that come up, to kind of give them the one-on-one service they need to work with those special collections. Anything else up here?
Did you mention the light tubes?
Oh, right. Yeah, these little circles that you see are light tubes, and those are a way to bring natural light in from outside. So they're basically, I don't know, like, I don't want to say holes in the ceiling, but they're tubes coming down from the roof line that allow for some natural light to come in and contribute to this being sort of the open, airy space that we'd like it to be. And then finally, this is a rendering that Marty Nystrom put together, kind of an answer to one of the ongoing questions of how are you going to make an office building look and feel like a library? Because those are two very different functions. So this is a mock-up that Marty made of a possible entrance to the library that would give you that sense of place and grandeur, and let you know that, like, we're in a library now. This is an institution of learning.
Okay, so I'll go through these questions fairly quickly. I think probably most people are here for the last question on the list, but I'll start from the top. So first question is, when will the bond vote be held? It'll be held May 10th. That's been scheduled, and it'll be conducted by the Ulster County Board of Elections. It'll be held at the community center, not at the library. How much will this cost? The bond is for $3.95 million. That will pay for both the purchase of the building and the repurposing of the interior of the building and the addition of the exterior change, the minimal exterior changes that we have. How long will it take? I don't have a good answer for that. I don't know the exact length it's going to take. Clearly, once we get the bond vote passed, we'll work with contractors, with engineers to find out what the schedule is going to be. The big advantage of doing this plan versus the plan that we had 2 years ago is that during the whole process of repurposing the building, the current library can stay open. And once we are done with the new building, we can move over from the new building to the old building, whereas the last plan we had to close for however long it took for the construction of the new building. How much will my taxes go up? I don't have an exact number for you on that yet. Still getting that from our bond counsel, or bond consultants. Those will be available shortly. What we'll publish is the tax rate change. So you'll be able to calculate your taxes based on your particular property value by multiplying that by the tax rate change. Will operating costs increase? In all honesty, probably yes, because it's a larger library with more services. So we will need to accommodate the larger, the expected increase in operating costs with this new building. And we'll do that through operating cost changes. There was a plan initially for an addition. That addition would have added a larger children's area and a presentation space. We have removed that from the plan. We removed it from the plan in order to keep the price to the minimal that we can do it. Any additional modifications to the building will not be a taxpayer expense, and there's nothing planned right now other than what we've shown here on the building. Red, the property is not currently zoned for the library. Is that true? That is true. The 10 Dixon Ave is in a zoning district called light industrial. And for some reason, libraries are not allowed in light industrial zone. The town has committed to changing that zoning restriction to allow libraries there. No one understands why that was ever the case. I think it was just a mistake. What will happen to the existing library building and property? I want to go to the next screen, Ivy. So just to give you an overview of the current building and the current property, there are actually three separate lots. The lawn lot is obviously where the lawn is. We will keep the library, we'll own the lawn forever. We may turn it over to the town of Woodstock, or we may turn it over to the Woodstock Land Conservancy, but whoever ends up owning it will have a deed restriction on it that it's forever green. The building and the old laundromat lots will be sold. They'll likely be sold as a unit so that the old laundromat lot can be used for parking for the building. That's basically it. The building sale will be after we've moved out of the building, obviously. Go back to the questions. How will the proceeds of the sale of the existing library be used? So I believe it was a few months ago, the library board passed a resolution that will create a external committee to look at the best use of the library funds, the funds from selling the property. That committee will make recommendations to the board, and the board will then proceed with the recommendations to figure out what the best use of the funds are from the sale of the property. Sale of the building, not the property. What about people who walk to the current library? That is definitely a concern and an issue. I think it's one of the biggest concerns people have. It's one of the biggest concerns that we as a library board also have. We have looked at a bunch of different solutions. One solution is to work with UCAT to expand their line out to the library. There's even talk of maybe expanding it all the way to Phoenicia, which would be great. There's the idea of putting a kiosk in the town, in the hamlet someplace, so people can drop off and pick up books. A couple of days ago, someone presented the idea of having volunteers, just like Meals on Wheels, being able to pick up people and drop them off at the library. Another person presented the idea of working with Trailway, to have them be able to pick up people with a library card and drop them off at the library for free. So there are options. Right now, a lot of these ideas are hypothetical. Once we move into the library, once we, the bond passes and we know we're gonna move there, we'll get more serious in preparing these things. Bottom line is, we feel the library is important to be accessible to everyone in the community. And we're gonna work very hard to make it accessible to everyone in the community. That's our commitment to Woodstock and to the community. Last question, what is the status of the environmental testing at 10 Dixon Ave? So the tests were completed on the 31st of March. The results came to me. I saw the results for the first time on Friday of last week, the full results. I had a hour-long discussion with our environmental engineers so that I understood the tests and could communicate what they say to the public. So here are the basics of the results. The first, that there are no volatile organic compounds in excess of state environmental limits. So there are no VOCs. So there are no semi-volatile organic compounds in excess of state environmental limits. So no SVOCs. No arsenic was found in the soil samples in excess of state environmental limits. And no lead also, no lead found either. lead and arsenic, I highlighted here because they were found in a 2012 sample conducted by the previous owner, or the current owners of the building, not the previous owner, current owners of the building. There was zinc found in soil, and the soil, that zinc was found 18 feet underground. And essentially, so long as no excavation is done, then it will not have any impact on the environment or people. We will put a deed restriction in the library property if we acquire it, that basically memorializes this so that anyone in the future who owns that building or works in that building knows if they do dig, that they need to be, that they need to take precautions against the zinc. The groundwater results found aluminum, iron, and manganese in excess of state environmental limits. These metals are all naturally occurring, and we believe, we don't know, we can't prove it yet. We're gonna work on understanding that, that the levels are high due to background levels in the area. And again, these are not particularly toxic things. The other thing about the groundwater tests is we do not get our water from wells, nor in the area gets the water from wells. They all get it from town, the town municipal water supply. So none of this will affect drinking water. Next. If there's a next. So make your voting plans. The voting will be held at the Mescal Hornback Community Center. That's 56 Rock City Road from 12 p.m. to 9 p.m. on Tuesday, May 10th. For a temporary ballot, you can pick them up online at the library. We have to do that. That's actually on our, so I'll drop some off at the library tomorrow or the next day. So we'll be able to pick, people will be able to pick them up at the library, pick up applications at the library.
Yeah, okay. And we do have applications at the library already as well.
Wonderful.
That's the thing. Okay. At the library, you can get your application, but you still have to get that into the Board of Elections to get the actual ballot. And so the deadline for mailing that into them is April 25th, which is coming up really soon, or you could hand deliver that application to the Board of Elections up to May 9th.
And you can actually vote at the Board of Elections as an early voter or absentee voter. You can actually vote there too. You can also apply online at absenteeballot.elections.ny.gov, and you can track the status of your absentee ballot at voterlookup.elections.ny.gov.
But yeah, we should emphasize if you can vote in person, then you don't have to do any of this temporary absentee ballot application or anything. If you're registered to vote, you can just show up on May 10th and vote at the community center. And also if you're on the permanent absentee ballot list, you'll get the ballot mailed to you automatically. So the temporary absentee ballot process is only if you, for whatever reason, can't be there to vote on May 10th.
Correct. Anything else we have on the slides, or we're back to more questions? Okay, so we're gonna do questions, and I'm gonna ask you to use your Zoom hand. Your Zoom hand is accessible on the reactions button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. If you click that, you will see a little dialogue and it will say raise hand across the bottom of it. If you click the raise hand, your hand will go up and I'll be able to see that. The benefit of doing it that way is that I know the order that people have raised their hand and I'll be able to call on people in order. So Rebecca.
Hi, thank you. Yeah. Okay, a few questions. First of all, regarding transportation, and I've been in contact with you by email about this. Mm-hmm. Not everybody drives. Not everybody is young and able-bodied, you know? I mean, I'm starting to get on in years. I'm still capable of walking the 2 miles, but it's not as easy for me as it was 20 years ago. And other people who are older than me and or handicapped and don't drive, you know, might find it impossible to walk the 2 miles. So I was wondering if any progress had been made regarding transportation to the library.
Again, you know, we're committed to providing transportation one way or another, Rebecca, and I don't have exact ways we're going to do that. As I said, we're working with UCAT to see if they will expand their bus coverage. We're going to talk with Trailways to see if people can hop on Trailways and get there free. We're looking at the idea of having volunteers being able to pick up, you know, vetted volunteers obviously be able to pick up and drop off at the library. And we're looking at having drop off and pickups for books in the hamlet someplace. It's a very big concern for all of us. You know, we understand that libraries need to be accessible to everyone. So we're going to work as hard as we can to do that. I don't have a committed answer to how we're going to do that yet. I do commit to you and to everyone else that we will find an answer to this and we'll make it available.
Thank you. I have another question regarding accessibility, and that's the accessibility of books on shelves that are 7 feet high. I mean, not everybody is 5'8 or taller. I'm only 5 feet tall, and I'm sure there are other people besides myself who are shorter than 5'8 and would not be able to reach a book on a top shelf of a shelving unit that's 7 feet high. Will there be some kind of step stools or kick stools for those of us who are vertically challenged so that we can reach the books?
That's an Ivy question.
Yeah. Well, I should clarify, to say that a shelf is 7 shelves high doesn't necessarily mean 7 feet high. I mean, we don't want to make the shelves any taller, you know, than they are now. But of course, any library, you do have the little stools, you know, to reach the tallest materials. But yeah, that's why we've tried throughout the building to keep the shelving, you know, 4 high or lower as much as possible for both accessibility and just for feeling like an open space. But 7 high isn't any higher than what you would see like in the building as it is now. So we're not going excessively higher at all.
I think another thing to point out is that the new building has the space to allocate between the stacks for wheelchairs, which the current building does not have. Is that correct?
Marty says
yes. I'm getting nods from the other board members, yes. Yeah. So it actually will be more ADA compliant than the current building can be.
But there will be step stools for those of us who are not of regulation height.
Yes.
I noticed virtually everything seems to be designed for somebody 8 inches taller than me. And that often presents a problem for me.
Definitely will be step stools.
On top shelves.
And support too, yeah.
And I have one more question, and that is, can you confirm that there will be outdoor seating for those of us who prefer the warmth of summer to the chill of air conditioning?
Yes, there's definitely that back porch has outdoor seating. And we can put benches around too. We haven't allocated where benches will be, but you know, definitely we'll have benches around too.
Okay, thank you. That's all.
Thank you. Anyone else? Marie.
Hi.
I think we have an echo, Marie. Oh, now you're muted.
Okay, I'm unmuted. A couple of questions. Is this library within walking distance of anyone in town? I mean, I'm not quite sure where.
Yes, actually, if you look at the actual numbers, it actually is going to be in walking distance of more people in town than the current library is because of all the residents of Bearsville. All the residents of Bearsville Flat will be able to walk to it, and it's in walking distance of them. There's actually more residents in Bearsville than there are in the hamlet.
So how far is it from the Bearsville complex? Do they have to walk on 212?
The Bearsville complex, I'm considering Bearsville Flats. And Dorothy, I'm going to defer to this to you because you live in that area.
The Bearsville Flats is a housing area that was built by IBM in the 50s of ranch houses. And there's lots of families and older single people living in the area. And it starts at Dixon Avenue, which is where the library is. And it goes all the way to Overlook Drive, where I live. And there's also Yeri Hill Road. And then there's roads within like Harder Drive. And I don't know the exact number of houses. I know that Jeff was saying when people do political canvassing, there's the greatest concentration of single family homes in a few block areas of anything, you know, of anywhere in town. there's also an area now to get from the Bearsville Center, which is where, you know, people don't live there. It's where restaurants and theater and stuff is. They would be walking along 212. But the what's in that area right now is if you walk from Dixon Avenue to where SunFrost Farm Stand and Cafe is, there are also behind where SunFrost is and where Overlook Methodist Church is, there's also a big residential area there. And the part where people would be walking along 212 is very short. And a lot of people in my neighborhood now walk to SunFrost or walk to the Bearsville Theater. But, you know, we're hoping, I think it's part of the complete streets plan. And I think if the library as a big civic institution ends up being located in the Bearsville Flats, it would be wonderful to have a sidewalk going at least, let's say, from Overlook Methodist Church to the Bearsville Center. You know, because there's so many things in that area. And then right past the Bearsville Center, you have the Cub Market and the Bearsville Post Office. So, you know, it's an area that people already walk in quite a bit. And what's great about the Bearsville Flats area for walking is it's all flat. It's like big, wide, flat streets. There aren't sidewalks, but the roads are very wide. And you know, I see elderly people in my neighborhood in their 90s, you know, who walk past my window every day. You know, people just walk around in a loop. And you also have the dog park off of Dixon Avenue that lots of people come to, and the Little League field down there. So it's really, it's one of the few kind of residential neighborhoods in Woodstock for families and older people. So, you know, I know my neighbors are very happy at the idea that they'd be able to go to the library, even if they drove there. There's a big parking lot and they won't have to go into town and deal with traffic and parking. So.
Right, of course, it's kind of a, you know, kind of a disadvantage that it won't be located where there's a lot of other businesses and things happening. I mean, in the village area of Woodstock, it's like there'll be two different areas of Woodstock, the Bearsville Flats area and the village area. And
well, there are several, between the Cub Market and SunFrost and the Dixon Roadhouse restaurant is on the corner there, as well as everything at the complex. So, you know, it's kind of, yeah, it is a second, it will be a secondary kind of center of activity for Woodstock. You know, but there's also Lizzie Van, who owns the Bearsville Center, has talked about in the summer perhaps having a little jitney for free to go from the Village Green to the Bearsville Center. So that would also, you know, if that idea takes off, you know, that could also help connect the two parts of the city, of the town, I should say.
That would be nice. Let me ask you something else. If this bond issue, I mean, the plans look very, very impressive to me, but if the bond issue does pass, is will the library be committed to this plan? Or if something else, you know, if it's decided that this is not the best plan, is can the money be used for another library plan? Such as, you know, building a new building on in the where the present library is, or once this bond issue is passed, does this mean that we have to go with this plan?
I believe, I'm not sure the technical answer to that, but I do know that no other plan would be any place close to the price that we're doing for this. Everything else would be at least twice the price that we're trying to get for this, that this bond is. If we We went through the process of looking at you know, replacing the building 2 years ago, and that price at that point was really $7 million. And this is, we're looking at $4 million. And that's, you know, with the inflation, that same plan that we tried to do 2 years ago would probably be $8 million now. So nothing that we could come up with would be less expensive than what we're trying to do here. I think that's one of the advantages of this. This is really the plan that is the most economical for the town. you can't do anything else than what we're doing for this amount of money. People have talked about, you know, there've been ideas floated about buying Lasher Building and doing stuff there. And it's like, that's gonna be probably $7-8 million to do that. Not just buying the building, but also then changing that building to be appropriate for a library. There was talk a while ago about, you know, using the community center to do the same thing and convert the community center to a library. And the problem with that is we lose a community center, which we need. We don't even own, the town owns it, not the library. And there's no space there, but that would also be basically a huge renovation that would probably cost multiple millions of dollars in new construction. So really looking at the numbers, this is the least expensive plan we can do to get a functional library. And I say functional because, and I mean functional, because right now we do not have a library that satisfies our plan of service. And that makes it non-functional, in my opinion. You know, we're getting by, our librarians are doing the best job they can do to make it as effective as possible, but the building does not support our needs, does not support what we're trying to do in town. So to get to where we want to go, this is the least expensive way to do it. Okay, I'm gonna move on. Marcia, you're next.
Hi, Jeff?
Yes.
Okay. Could you just briefly go over the phase one environmental study that we did?
Yeah, I'll do that. So the phase one environmental study is looking at existing conditions and looking at previous phase ones and phase two done on the property. So the things that we have found are, you know, basically good things, that the septic field is sufficient for a library, that there are no underground tanks. There were two above ground fuel tanks back in 2012. Both of those were removed and both of those were examined with and determined to not have any leakage into the ground. What else can I tell you? The building itself, questions have been asked about radon because the building's on a slab. There's no radon in the building. There's no availability for radon in the building. Plus we're exchanging the air, I think 10 times an hour. Martin can tell me if I'm correct on this. I think that's the new code for air exchange. So radon will not be an issue, even if there's radon in the area. The building is a sound building. It was renovated 7 years ago and it was done really, really well. It's, if you've walked in the building, it feels solid, it looks solid. It's well done. Incredibly well renovated. The exterior will be unchanged. We won't have to do a thing to the exterior other than what we've talked about, which is adding the ADA elevator and adding the covering the front porch. We'll keep probably the same paint on the exterior of the building. So all those things that we already have, don't have to spend money on, save us money in this building. And we've done the design of the interior. I'm gonna say we, Marty Lystrom, has done the design of the interior to reduce expenses and make it as affordable as possible. You know, I gave him a budget and he's worked within that budget and we'll continue to work within that budget. So we have kept an eye on the cost and we are committed to keeping the cost to something that the town can afford and hopefully we can pass. Did I miss anything, Marcia? Got it, okay, thank you. Sarah, you're up.
Hi, I don't live in Woodstock, obviously, but have an interest in what's going on there. And I guess I was mostly curious about, with your vote coming up so soon, what your other efforts, besides this meeting you've taken and plan to take to get information to the public about the vote and the bond and to get the right kind of turnout and get it passed.
So this is the fourth of these meetings, Sarah, and we're gonna have an additional one next week, I believe, right, Ivy? And that's gonna be an in-person one, is that correct?
Yeah, the next one is a week from now, Wednesday the 27th, in person at the community center. And it'll be another one of these meetings where we present the plans, give updates, and then take community feedback as well.
All of the plans are online at the library website. There is a description of the plan, description of the process. We will have people answering phone calls. We have a phone number specifically set up for this to have that will come directly to me. And so if you want to call about the library, use that phone number and I'll answer the phone. It's 845-600-0032. And we will be having people go out to knock on doors and to answer questions. I think library board members have already started doing that or started calling people to let them know what's going on and to encourage them to vote. It's stuff in the paper. We obviously have to do public notices in the next couple of days to let people know about the election. We're trying to get the word out as best as we can. As you, I'm sure you know, it's tough to get the word out because of our lack of Woodstock times. It's tough to get the word out because there's just no, that we don't have the same level of communication we used to have in Woodstock when we had the Woodstock times. I think the people have not read HV1 as much as Woodstock times, unfortunately. But there's definitely been articles in the Freeman and HV1, I think, the last couple of days, there's been a couple articles and we're working as hard as we can to get the word out. It's always tough to get word out.
Okay, thanks. Good luck.
Thank you very much. Peter, you're up.
Yes, thank you very much. I've only lived here 8 years and this has been going on throughout my tenure as a resident here. It's been going on a multiple of those many years. And I am really excited and thrilled that you have all persevered to come up with this miraculous plan to use such a well-constructed, large, very modern building to serve all the people of Woodstock, including all the children. We need children in this town, and this is going to be a charming factor for young families, if they can afford to live here, which is always going to be a problem. But you are solving a giant problem in the most wonderful way. And I don't hear of a lot of opposition, and I'm very thrilled. I'm very, very grateful and excited that you've done this, and I'm glad the testing came out well. And I trust somehow that this will all proceed. Your plans for reorganizing the interior of the building look really wonderful. And I can't wait to go in there once you've finished. I'm really also happy that you're going to keep the lawn of the old library and maintain it as the Land Conservancy or the town would, as a green space in a town that is going to become really ever more developed over time. And this library will serve that town and that space will stay green. So thank you so much for everything you've done. That's all I have to say. I'm just very happy.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you. Here, you're up.
Hi, thank you for calling me. I just want to let the folks who have tuned in here know that a group of people who find that it is amazing how much money has been spent on the various efforts that Peter Hall referred to. No, you could have renovated the original historic library by now with that money. And we're mystified as why you haven't, even though you say this is wrong, that is wrong, this is wrong, that is wrong. As we all know, who live in 1830 houses here in Woodstock, everything can be renovated, everything. And I mean everything, because old houses love work and they take work, but that's what they do. And we have a town here that is made up of a lot of old houses on the main drag, Tinker Street, which have been converted to businesses, but that's the character of this town. And I don't want that character taken away, nor do a lot of other people, including engineers who have studied all of the reports, including the 2012 rather, engineering report, which cited lead and arsenic in the ground of this purchase you're making above acceptable levels. I don't want any grandchildren of mine sitting on that lawn. I don't want anybody in my family drinking anything from that building. It is toxic. And it is not something that can be remediated that easily. And there's no recommended, there's no record existing of remediation of the lead and arsenic. So you got here a building that's toxic. And you know who's going to pay for the remediation? All the taxpayers. So buying it is foolish. The vote should be postponed. There is absolutely no reason on earth that the lawyers you're using can't postpone that closing. Every lawyer in every building I have ever bought has postponed the closing. The May 10th deadline is a ridiculous deadline to push upon the public when you're trying to get us to buy a toxic building. Give me a break. I would never do that. Renovate what you got. You know, it is a wonderful building. We have two engineers who have studied the reports, and they say this is absolute foolishness. It is not safe.
Do you have a question? Harry, do you have a question, or you just want to?
Yeah, I wonder what you're going to put on the ballot. You haven't even told us. What's on the ballot?
We have told you what's on the ballot. It's $3.95 million.
Oh, yeah. In other words, we're supposed to give the library $4 million for what?
Harry, do you have a question?
Yes. What is the wording on the ballot?
The wording on the ballot will be released tomorrow. It's the town attorney is the one that's determining the wording on the ballot. He has not given us his answer yet. So if you want to ask the question, ask the town attorney. I don't have the answer.
Okay. So we're going to vote on something that we don't have the wording on.
The wording will be available tomorrow, Hera.
Thank you very much. And why aren't the lawyers postponing the closing so that you who are getting a private sale set up can quit putting this pressure on people? At the last session, Erica Obi was very upset about the pressure you're putting on everybody. Lawyers always postpone closings.
I've explained before, and I'll explain again, that there's a deadline.
By the deadline's a closing.
Hera, I've explained it. Thank you.
You have not explained why the weather. Here's my question. Have you asked those lawyers to postpone your closing so all the information can be studied?
Yes, Hera, I have asked. If we can postpone it, the answer is no.
Well, why on earth? It's a private sale. Nobody's competing with you to buy that building.
Hera, it's
my answer. My question's why?
I've answered the question, Hera. Hera, I've answered the question.
You have not answered why you can't postpone the closing.
I cannot postpone the closing because the seller does not want us to postpone the selling, the closing. That's the answer.
He wants to get rid of what is a toxic building, and you have signed agreement.
Hera.
I want to know why you signed a sales agreement that said the taxpayer would pay for remediation. We are going to be stuck with a Superfund site.
Hera,
that building is upstream from the town well. It's totally irresponsible, and I will send you a map that shows that it is upstream, and anything there, when you disturb the soil, is going to run down into the town well.
Okay, Hera, first of all, we're not disturbing any soil. Secondly, the test that came in from our engineering firm, I showed you the exact, I showed the results of those tests. Those tests indicate that there are no issues with the building.
Not if it's an industrial use. If it's a library use, those
no, not for any use. Not for any use, Hera, not for any use.
No, industrial thresholds are different for library thresholds.
Hera, did you see the results?
Yes.
If you look at the results, okay. If you look at the results, I don't want to argue, Hera. You're just wrong.
No, of course you don't want to argue because you are pushing a toxic building into the hands of the taxpayers. I'm very concerned. So are engineers. Joe Mangan, who was early involved in the Library Facilities Task Force, said this is a free-for-all. We're going to end up with a Superfund site. Joe Doan, who's
that's
an engineer.
That's absolutely not the case, Hera. And I'm going to stop you now because you're just saying the same thing over and over again.
You can stop me all you want, but we are not going to put up with this.
Fine. There's
taxpayers don't want that burden.
They will not have a burden, Hera.
It's going to be a huge burden to remediate that site. If you have have to build a bigger septic to accommodate kids peeing.
Hera, you're creating false information.
It's not false information. You've created
false
information.
Because you're not listening. Even the town supervisor said that there is not concern and he's looked at the results of this.
Well, how about two engineers looking at it?
You are creating misinformation.
No, don't mind
the building is the current library.
Well, the current library has not been tested for the thresholds for a library. It's been tested for
toxic, full of mold, and it's in a flood zone. Yeah. You ever heard of global warming, Hera?
Yes, but you know what?
Anyone else get in here?
We're in the area of questions, and we've gotten the area of attacks, and we don't.
The current library can be renovated.
Oh, yeah.
Can anyone else get into this free for all?
Go right ahead. Hera, how are you?
You're not asking questions anymore. You're just attacking now. So you're done. Thank you.
Mute.
Okay, John, you're up next. John Ludwig, sorry.
Thank you. I'm interested in knowing about the air quality in the building at 10 Dixon. Has that been looked into at all?
Mm-hmm. I assume it's been part of the phase one. The air movers in the 10 Dixon are going to change the air out every 10 times an hour. They're going to meet the state requirements for air quality.
I'm talking about to assess the air quality presently in the building. Things come up through the slab, for example.
I don't know the answer to that, John. I don't think that that's an issue. The air movers are there. That's what they're there for.
You say you don't think it's an issue, and that's based on what?
What's on the ground, John? There's nothing in the ground.
Well, I'm. It's
the
a,
test shows
it's
there's an, nothing in the ground except zinc.
It's an industrial.
Not the. I'm sorry. Lead, that was a misstatement. There's nothing in the ground except zinc.
Jeff,
and aluminum.
We've seen the long list of compounds that are in the ground.
All of which are below state levels. All of which are below state limits.
Right.
Every single one is below state limits, John.
Right.
Every single one.
So I'm asking about the air quality in the building because of the industrial site, turning it into a residential use. I guess it hasn't been tested.
Below state limits for residential use.
And is there any plan? Right. Those are the limits for the ground. But I'm talking about the air quality. And is there any plan to test the air?
I don't know the answer to that, whether that's part of the phase one, whether it was part of the phase one or not. I do know that there are no VOCs and no SVOCs, nothing that volatilizes that is above the state limits, period. I mean, again, you're creating a false narrative that there's toxins where there are no toxins.
There are toxins there. And the question is, how much and will they get up into
the
air that people
breathe?
And
the answer is in the report, John. The answer is in the report.
The air quality?
Read the report, you'll see the answers. If it's below state limits, then it's safe, according to the state. If you don't believe the state...
I'm asking specifically about the air quality.
VOCs in the ground affect what's in the air, correct? If it's below state limits, then it's safe for people to be in that area. That's what the state. That's what the tests say.
I didn't see that in the report.
Okay, well, maybe you need to understand how the report works better. I'm sorry if you didn't see it. It's there.
I didn't see air quality.
And there are no SVOCs.
I didn't see air quality addressed in the report, and I think it would be good to test that to make sure that there isn't a long-term problem. And perhaps the referendum should be put off until those numbers are in.
There isn't. The tests show no VOCs, no SVOCs, period. The tests show no problems with organic compounds or vapors, period. I'm sorry you don't like the test, John. I'm sorry the tests don't make your life.
I don't like them. I'm asking a question about the air quality in the building.
Okay, I've answered it.
Thank you.
Nora. Jeff, can I just add to answer to John?
Okay.
What I think is interesting, I mean, we do have Luanna's on the call who has worked at Miller Howard for several years. I have not heard any peep of any employees at Miller Howard having any issues with air quality. And as we know, our current library has terrible air quality, which is why a lot of people don't use it. And we've had staff people resign because of health issues because of it. So you know, I'm certainly not concerned about the air quality there in a building that has modern HVAC systems and, you know, evidence of problem, but, you know, doesn't mean a test can't be done, but I don't know if Luann wants to say anything, but.
I mean, I can tell you that we bought the building. We spent millions of dollars developing it. It's a brand new building that was gutted. And we had people working there. It wasn't an industrial site for the last, you know, since we bought it in 2013, it was an office building with people where we tested the air quality, where we have a very modern HVAC system. It hasn't been an industrial site since the, you know, Model Optics closed in 2012. So there's a little bit of a disconnect here and what we're talking about in the state of the building. It's not exactly what you're envisioning when you talk about a light industrial site. And it's certainly not a Superfund site, but you know, it's up to the community to decide.
Nora, you're still up.
Okay, it's actually Doug of Doug and Nora. Okay.
Thank yeah. you.
Doug Shear. I view the library, I view all libraries, but this library in particular for Woodstock as a major cultural institution, not just an educational institution. And I view it in its current setting as underperforming, you know, undercapable. And that's too bad. I think if there's any toxicity we should be concerned about, it's the toxicity that has prevented this from coming to the point it's at now, which is being able to see a real solution in front of us. And it's a solution that in addition to potentially being a very wonderful addition to the cultural spectrum of what's in Woodstock, but more importantly, very, very future-proof, very much a building that is capable of bending with the kinds of changes that will be coming in the next few decades in terms of communication, in terms of library science, and in terms of where the village is growing to. So the village is expanding. The village now having some 6,000 residents by the time the library is into its second decade, let's say at Dixon, we probably will have a village that has 10,000 residents, maybe more. So I think that the building and the plans as we've seen them and the people that are involved in crafting them is a winning combination that we should appreciate, and I hope to be around to help nurture. Thank you.
Thank you. Marie. You're still on mute, Marie. There you go.
Okay, thank you. And just one question, because I didn't quite catch it in the presentation. I know you did find aluminum, iron, and manganese in excess, but did you say that the library will be served by municipal water?
It already is, yes.
It already is?
It already is.
Okay.
All of Bearsville is on municipal water.
Oh, yes. Okay. All right.
Yep. And again, okay. That doesn't necessarily mean that what we found would get to the well water level. It's only down at about 18 feet. So it may or may not get to the, you know, but again, nobody in that area has well water. Everyone in that area has municipal water, which is tested every single day. So it's definitely safe to drink the water. As safe as it is to drink any water in the hamlet, it's the same water.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And
the water we get at the library today is the same water we get at the library in the future if we move there.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions? I'm going to wait because there's almost always more questions. Nothing? Okay. Any board members want to? Oh, I'm going to go with Robert. Thank you, Robert. Robert, you're up and you're on mute.
Thanks, Jeff. And for everyone's information, I'm with the Woodstock Environmental Commission. My only question is, Jeff, when can we take a look at the full report with figures and boring depths and things like that?
I can send you the test results today. I'll send you an Excel sheet if you want to take a look at that. It's actually on the website. It's on, if you go to the library website, you can click the link and it'll download the Excel.
Yeah,
test results.
Yeah, I saw that. I wanted just to see the full report that had
figures. The report's not ready yet. I've heard it's going to be prepared and available sometime next week for us, the written report, which basically is going to summarize this data. The phase one report is available. Is that on the website also? So you can see the phase one report, which shows the previous phase ones and phase twos done by Miller Howard.
Yeah, I read that. Thanks.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll
just, any questions I'll just about add, that?
Oh, I'll just add really quickly for anybody who does want to see these various reports. All of the information we're sharing about this proposal, including all the reports that we have, are on woodstock.org/planning. And on the main page of the library's website, there's a planning button you can click, and that takes you to all the information we're sharing tonight, the various reports, past presentations, all of that stuff.
I would just want to point out that, you know, the last meeting we had on this, I said I was not going to release anything until we had the reports from the written reports. I changed my mind because I was able to spend an hour on the phone with the engineer so I could understand what these results meant and explain them if I had to explain them. So that's why we've released the test results that allows them to get out to the community sooner than later. And we're obviously very open for people to take a look at these. Like I said, the only things on this, and I could show you the Excel sheets, but it's a lot of data, are the things we highlighted. The zinc 18 feet under, and then the stuff in the water, which is just aluminum, iron, and manganese.
And thank you for doing that, Jeff. That was very helpful getting that out quickly.
Yeah, and I apologize. It got sent out as a PDF, John, and that's what you saw at first. And I think that this has been fixed, so it's in Excel that you can download. Yeah. Dorothea, it actually looks like Tim to me.
It actually is Tim, yes. Hi, Jeff. Hey.
How you doing?
Great presentation. I have just one question. I know that the town board has still got to take an action in some area. And could you be clear about what remains to be done at the town board level?
So the town board doesn't really need to take an action before we pass the bond or even after. Basically, what we need to clear up is the restriction in the zoning code that prevents libraries from being in light industrial. It's been planned for at least a year that would be changed. What the town board is committed to doing now is just changing the zoning code. It takes a little bit of time to do that, but that'll happen in time. And they'll give us an exemption until they get that done. We are not going for an MOU because it's controversial for some reason. We are not going for the resolution that the town board discussed because that's controversial for some reason. We don't need those to proceed. We just need to be clear that we have the right to have a library in that zone. So we're working that out.
And what guarantees that at this point? You seem to think that it's going to go through cleanly. What is that based on?
Because all five members of the town board have committed to doing this to me personally. They could not come to agreement on the resolution or the MOU, but they came to agreement that this particular aspect of it is fine to change. It's also the zoning review committee has proposed to the town board and has gotten through the zoning review committee also. So, which I happen to be a member of, coincidentally.
So in a follow-up, Jeff, the seeker process, where are we with that right now?
I don't want to give the wrong terms. It's almost complete. I don't want to say the wrong thing. We'll release that because if I use the wrong
process,
it'll confuse things up. It's in process, and it'll be, I think, published tomorrow or the next day.
Well, it sounds good.
The great. Seeker, okay. Yeah. And again, if I use the wrong words, it'll confuse people, and I don't have the right words necessarily. So
yeah, well, the floor plans look great. Thank you for the walkthrough, Ivy, and forward.
Yeah, and I want to just also thank, you know, again, Marty, and I want to thank Howard for working on the floor plans too. And I want to thank the community input on the floor plans and the librarians input on the floor plans, because it's very much changed from the initial plans. And the changes are incredibly, significantly better. I like the, I like the walking through with the young, middle age, older age. And if you have, if you notice, the stacks get higher as you walk through. It was kind of a nice little touch there. They start at four levels and they go to seven levels. So
yeah,
it was an interesting touch on that.
One thing I was thinking of, our old floor plan for the last plan had a larger conference room with a table that would seat something like 8, maybe 10 people. And I'm wondering if that would be possible.
I don't know that we could do it that way. We might be able to use that multi-purpose room and be able to put a couple tables together to make that kind of a size. I don't know for sure. There's definitely space for that if we can make the table fit in there.
A large room just below that multi-purpose room that could accommodate a group of that size, yeah.
Oh, sounds good. Good work, everyone.
Dorothea, Dorothea now.
The real, I know, the alter ego. Anyway, I want to thank Marty again for, coming up with a quick kind of design to make the entrance to the library look, you know, more imposing and like an official civic building. And of course, that's still going to be in the rear of the building towards the parking lot. So I'm sure, I just want to assure David Eckroth isn't on the call tonight, the one who keeps making this point.
He's not.
But no. Obviously there's going to be signage. There's going to be a sign on the lawn in front of the library that I'm sure will look impressively civic, that will identify it as the Woodstock Library, and arrows to go into the parking lot for the library. As a matter of fact, I know on the board, we several years ago, we wanted, you may notice on Route 375, there's a little library icon sign where you turn in to go to the West Hurley Library off 375. Mm-hmm. And we talked about getting some of those signs around Woodstock to point to where the library is, because often tourists, when visitors in town ask, they want to know where the library is. So I think especially with our moving, it would be very helpful if we can do whatever is necessary. I don't know if we have to involve the New York State in it because 212 is a state road, but to have those directional signs with the I forget what the library icon looks like. Ivy probably knows, like it's probably a book, but that will show people easily how to get to the library. So, and it's certainly very easy to find. It's, it's not gonna be hidden away. So I just wanna thank everyone again and thank everyone for participating tonight.
I want to thank everyone also. No more questions. Any other board members want to say anything? I want to thank Luann also for being here and for being a great partner in this process and suffering through our process. It can't be fun being someone that's going through the same with us. It's been tough. It's been a long time. But I really appreciate what you've done with us and for us, and deeply, deeply appreciate it. Okay, thank you very much. And I we'll have one more of these in person next week, and we'll answer the same, whatever questions come between now and then. Truly, I think this is the opportunity that we have to bring this town together around the library, to bring this town together around a functional library building that supports a plan of service that we can be proud of. And I know we have had issues getting together in the town on this, but I feel different about this. I feel like there is such support about this. I feel like there are people that are excited about the idea of moving forward finally in this process. And that's what I think is going to happen. So we'll get out there. We'll ask people to get out and vote. We'll make sure that people know when the election is. We'll make sure people do vote. and we'll be contacting people in town. So thank you. Thank you so much. And thanks for coming to this. Appreciate it.
And I'll just say as one last note that the recording of this meeting will go onto our YouTube page tomorrow alongside the recordings of all of the past similar meetings that we've had. So if you know anybody who wasn't able to make it here tonight but wants to know more about it, please point them to woodstock.org/planning, and that's where they can read everything, get links to the videos, get links to the plans, see everything that we presented here tonight.
Okay, good night.